take all them houses. Oh, I hope she's done.
Hey, that's a tornado, I think. It is. Look at that, Don.
It's not going to miss us. Yes.
Tornadoes, a deadly matter, a WDIV special presentation. And now, here's your host, Chuck Gatica.
Good evening, and welcome to Tornadoes, a Deadly Matter. For this, our fifth annual tornado special, we've decided to travel right to the heart of Tornado Alley. For it's right here in Oklahoma, and Texas for that matter, unique types of severe thunderstorms develop, the kind of storms that produce nature's most violent tornadoes. During the next half hour, we're going to show you how and why these special storms develop. And we'll also hear about a professional tornado chaser and his whirlwind tours. And you will join us as we take a walk on the wild side, a tornado search of our own.
And we've had a funnel reported at Lake Worth near west of Fort Worth. And we just had a lowering reported near Weatherford.
Uh-huh.
It's only 6 o'clock, so we got time to get in there.
But why are Oklahoma and Texas such tornado hotspots? The answer is the dry line. It's a simple concept, but it is a potent tornado trigger.
Hey, that's a tornado, I think. It is. Look at that, Don.
Oh, it's unpredictable. Oh, my God. Oh, how weird.
Here in the Midwest, approaching cold fronts generate most of our severe thunderstorms. As the fronts move east, warm, moist, unstable air is pulled northward, and storms typically develop out ahead of the front and then move with it. Summertime cold fronts, however, rarely make it all the way down south, but other triggers are available, and one of the most potent ones is the dry line. Here's how it works. Strong south or southeasterly winds push tons of Gulf moisture northward into Texas and Oklahoma. This moisture-laden air differs sharply from the normally dry air over New Mexico, and the boundary between the two air masses is known as the dry line. Because 80% of all western Texas and Oklahoma thunderstorms are dry line generated, tornado chasers carefully monitor its movement, pinpointing its location to within a few miles.
Well, let me put it this way. Garden City is on the southern boundary of the lowest pressure. It has southern winds. It's right on the dry line.
And under the right circumstances, dry line thunderstorms can be ferocious. On Tornadoes, a Deadly Matter.
I want to pull over.
Oh yeah, we don't want to get much closer than this. It's right out there.
You could lap over in this direction, can't you?
You'll meet a professional tornado chaser. Talk about a dangerous way to make a living. And a bit later, we go searching for nature's most ferocious storm. For most of you, the closest you ever want to get to a tornado is watching one on television. But the prevailing attitude here in Oklahoma and Texas is something a little different. As a matter of fact, there's a fellow who makes a pretty good living taking people on close encounters of the dangerous kind.
Let's get as close as we can safely get.
That's a beauty. Whoa, look how thick it is on the ground.
Yeah, it's on the ground now.
Tornado chasing is nothing new. With camcorders and cameras in hand, daredevils have chased tornadoes for years. But this chaser is different. Why? He's trying to make a living doing it.
Now, in 1992, after I'd been chasing about 8 years, I had a lot of people trying to hook up with me to chase. And back then the customary thing, and still is to split expenses. And it got to the point in 1992 where people were just paying all my expenses. They were buying my motel rooms, they were buying my meals, and it really got me thinking, you know, well, if everybody wants to chase with me, maybe I can make a business out of this.
How close are you actually getting to these tornadoes?
The closest one I got to last year would have been on May 5th. There were dozens of chasers on that storm. It was a classic chase situation where there was one isolated supercell storm and everybody was just drawn to it from 100, 200 miles around. The second tornado was the one that we were quite close to. In fact, as far as I know, we were the closest person to it, and that second tornado crossed the road less than 2 miles in front of us.
So, how does the National Weather Service view these chasers?
Well, they have an actual purpose to what they're doing, Paul. Although their purpose isn't necessarily in line with the National Weather Service, we work with them closely because they bring some good benefits to us. First of all, they give us real-time spotter reports. They provide post-weather verification for our storm events and our warnings. And additionally, they provide some videos and still shots that I use extensively in my spotter weather training.
Do they ever get in the way?
I'd say yes. On occasion, it can be quite hectic. If you have severe weather day going on and 25 spotters show up on a Sunday afternoon, it's obviously a problem for the forecaster to deal with.
I'm out there not just to see tornadoes. I'm out there to see supercells, and if you can get a tornado, you know, that's the icing on the cake. But the most exciting thing to me is when I'm close to a tornado or close to a supercell is the inflow.
Underground.
There's dust.
Yep.
Right on the ground.
Dust on the ground.
If it's a good storm, you're going to have 40, 50 mile an hour wind being sucked into that storm at your back, and that's very exciting. You're actually part of the storm environment.
Despite the obvious risks, two of this year's three whirlwind tours are sold out. In fact, one Ypsilanti man loves the chase. He's a whirlwind veteran from 1993.
Always had an interest in severe weather and storms, and I first read about storm chasing in 1986.
I was so worried.
Don't see a definite tornado yet. But it's just incredible.
The best storm was June 2nd, and it was in southeast Colorado. It was a ominous sight. It was exciting. And we, later on in the storm, as we tried to maneuver, we got into some hail.
It's pulling. Hail, at least off ball side. Oh, Jesus, the wind chill. We're going to have to pull over. Well, it looks like we're going to have to ride this out.
California native John Brosio is a first-time whirlwind tourist.
I hope to see a lot of storms. I think people in California think that this place is just covered with tornadoes, the same way that people out here are terrified of earthquakes. A lot of them won't set foot out there. But when you get out here, you realize that they're pretty rare, and that my chances of seeing one are maybe slimmer than I hoped. If I could arrange it, I'd love to be under the overpass, like that footage in 1991, and really feel some of the wind. I would love to see a tornado.
We shouldn't judge these people who chase tornadoes. Some people like to bungee jump, some people hang glide, others go mountain climbing. This is just another high-risk hobby. However, like those other hobbies, you really need specialized training to chase tornadoes. Quite frankly, if you don't know what you're doing, you could get hurt, or worse. Up next on Tornadoes, a Deadly Matter, tornado chaser Marty Feely takes us out for a country ride, a ride that we hope will capture a Texas twister. Our first chase day began at 9:15 a.m. as tornado chaser Marty Feely turned our rented Ford Explorer into a fully equipped chase vehicle, complete with cellular phone, scanner, portable television, CB radio, detailed road maps of all surrounding states, a can of Fix-A-Flat, and Rain-X. That's right, Rain-X, which is one of the most important chaser possessions to ensure good visibility when driving into torrential downpours. Part of being a successful chaser is preparation, and Feely leaves no stone unturned.
Well, there are a lot of stupid reasons for missing tornadoes. Things like missing a turn, running out of gas, having a flat tire, and part of your job is to eliminate as many stupid reasons as possible. Because you can do everything right, and the storm that you're on can produce a tornado, and then you don't see it because of some stupid thing.
Yeah.
We gotta eliminate as many of those things as we can.
We decided to head for Amarillo, which would be very close to the Texas dry line, a possible focal point for today's thunderstorm development. However, thunderstorm potential today was marginal. But if storms did develop, conditions were such that they would undoubtedly become severe, possibly with tornadoes.
Thunderstorms are expected to develop along the dry line late this afternoon as a persistent moves eastward through Arizona and New Mexico. Emergency management and storm spotter groups in western Oklahoma and the western part of North Texas should stay updated on weather developments this afternoon. Activation may be required tonight and or Monday.
We are risking seeing nothing down here, but if storms do develop in West Texas on the dry line, then it's very likely they will be spectacular. There'll be an isolated storm that you can see with no mid-level clouds in the way. And if you can get in a situation where you're on the south side of an isolated supercell with a clear sky to the south, then that's the ultimate.
Yep.
You'll see a storm that just boggles your mind. You'll think, what planet am I on?
Midway to Amarillo, we stopped to assess the local conditions.
Well, it's not looking like a great classic chase day to me right now. I don't have my compass out, but it appears that we have a south-southwest wind.
Yeah.
I hope it's not all the way a southwest.
Arriving at the Amarillo National Weather Service office around 3 p.m., we found three other chase groups already there. Clearly, we all had the same idea. A lengthy weather analysis began, and arguments for and against potential severe weather were discussed.
Then he said it wouldn't break until 3 o'clock in the morning.
Huh.
That's what he told me. So he said that the forcing doesn't get in there until after. It might be midnight, you know, Garden City and the Kansas.
Yeah, but Colorado, the only thing is, I mean, the temperature differences here with this kind of system coming, it could break down. It could erode real quick, especially at 79, you know, 10 degrees difference here.
The Weather Service's new Doppler radar showed a few storms developing northeast of Amarillo, but nothing spectacular. Still, we waited. Around 6 p.m., it became apparent that today would be a bust. There would be no severe storms to chase, no tornadoes to document. But this isn't always the case for these tornado chasers.
Getting that?
Yeah.
Wow!
Holy sh...
Think it's gonna fall apart right over us. There it goes, right over it.
Still on the ground.
Let's get out of the way of it.
The 4.5-hour ride back to Oklahoma City was quiet, but filled with anticipation. A major severe weather outbreak was expected tomorrow. More on that in a minute. Remember that tornado chasing is very dangerous business. Leave the videotaping to the pros, and just concentrate on getting yourself and your family to a place of safety. Now, here are some important safety tips. A tornado watch means that tornadoes are possible in and around a watch area. This is a time to prepare and be alert for rapidly changing weather. A tornado warning means that a tornado has been sighted on radar or by a person in the field. This means to take cover immediately and keep a flashlight and portable radio handy. Seek shelter in the lowest, centermost part of your house or building, preferably a basement. Stay away from windows, outside walls, and if in a high rise, avoid elevators. If threatened, leave mobile homes and cars for sturdier shelter. If no buildings are nearby, then lie in a ditch and protect your head. Always remember that hail, lightning, high winds, and heavy rain can also cause severe damage. Don't wait for a warning. If you feel threatened, seek shelter immediately. In just a moment, it's back to the chase as we have a close encounter with a storm that became a killer. April 25th began early when Paul Gross was granted rare access to the Project Vortex office in Oklahoma City. These highly trained tornado researchers buzzed with anticipation, as well they should have. A large outbreak of severe thunderstorms was expected today, with the potential for unusually violent tornadoes.
This is probably one of the most potent severe weather situations I've seen in quite a while, at least in several years, for the plain states. A large area from Texas northward all the way into the upper Mississippi Valley is under the gun today. And as the afternoon and evening wears on, there's a high potential for these storms to produce tornadoes, widespread areas of large hail, damaging winds.
Are any tornadoes that do develop expected to be of a particular violent nature or a particular long track variety?
Oh yes, most definitely. These could be long track, violent tornadoes. If they happen to hit a town, we could see a lot of destruction.
And by the end of the day, Brannock's prophecy would come true. A tornado watch was already in effect when we picked up tornado chaser Marty Feely. We headed southwest toward an isolated severe storm in southwest Oklahoma, blowing by a tornado research vehicle in the process.
I think we'll go out to Highway 81, go south, try to intercept it somewhere west of Chickasha, maybe. And it's moving very fast, though. It's going to be difficult to nail it.
An hour later, we were closing in.
Okay, it's 1:13. We are in Chickasha, Oklahoma. And we have a squall line that has developed on the dry line from Dewey County south to the latest warnings are for the Lawton area.
However, Murphy's Law struck as we got hung up at a roadblock on a back road, and we lost the storm. We decided to pull over and regroup. At this point, our chase didn't have much meat to it.
Well, the closest encounter we've had is with a bunch of cows.
Word then came about a severe storm exploding over Jack County, Texas, and we proceeded south on a course aimed directly into the storm's path.
We're a few miles southwest of Decatur on Highway 51, and dead ahead is a storm. Spotters are reporting all kinds of pre-tornadic activity. Looks like we may have a developing supercell here.
As we approached Fort Worth, it became obvious that we were chasing a significant storm. Then suddenly, a funnel cloud began developing right before our eyes.
As soon as you can get a view, beyond this hill, past the hill.
It's about 7:20 in the evening, and we're on I-20 on our way to Dallas, and we just saw a funnel cloud. Now, this is an area in which we saw it, and the rain that came down appeared to undercut that funnel. But what we've got now is an obvious lowering of the clouds. This little part of the cloud cover that's dropping down, the lighter clouds, that's called scud cloud. That's actually wrapping around and going up into the cloud cover. So this is an area that we're watching here for the potential of maybe some more development of a funnel cloud or a tornado. Now you can see the rain off on the horizon. And what's interesting is that this is the one storm that we've been chasing for a while. And as we're now looking back on off to the west, we can see more storm clouds just punching back into the atmosphere. This is what we've been looking for all through the day.
The explosive development of this second storm needed a closer look, so we headed west, right toward it.
All right, we're crossing the median. We're going to head back west and see if we can get a bead on these storms that you can see just over that crossing here on the expressway on I-20. Headed away from Dallas.
After a quick stop to gauge the storm's progress, we decided that this would be the storm of the day. So we continued down the freeway, seeking out the highest possible vantage point. This is what the storm looked like on the big picture. Judging from the storm's movement, it was heading right for us. The still intensifying storm passed right overhead with strong wind, torrential rain, and marble-sized hail. However, our chase ended there because it was getting dark, and even experienced chasers don't follow severe storms after dark. And now you can see why. Our storm intensified further and dropped baseball-sized hail and a killer tornado just south of Dallas. Had we continued east on the interstate, which passes south of Dallas, we would have driven dangerously close to the storm's core. Here in Tornado Alley, you always have to have your camera ready. Paul Gross photographed this tremendous thunderstorm while waiting for his flight home from Oklahoma City. Here's what was happening under that storm at the very same time.
Hey, see that tornado right there?
I've seen several of them.
Hey, oh, well.
Did you slip it back up and bang it down?
Yeah, it's still on the ground.
Headed west on
90.
That sucker's coming north.
Okay.
Down there.
Get
him down.
Call them, they found the cellar. They said call me if you see one, and I can't call them.
There goes our power.
The storm scored a direct hit on Gainesville, Texas. Then suddenly, one tornado became two.
I think you ought to take them off.
Look at the rubber.
Look at that one. I've never seen one like that. I've never seen one.
1607 by.
Yep.
How ironic. After driving 1,226 miles in search of tornadoes, a single storm with two tornadoes almost found us. So Paul Gross and I left Tornado Alley, leaving behind plenty of work for our newfound friends and colleagues. Well, that's our show for tonight. Thanks for joining us. You know, when the weather takes a turn, you know you can turn to Weather Watch 4 for the latest bulletins and warnings if necessary. Our first warning system will be activated to bring you warnings first every time. For our Weather Watch 4 staff, I'm Chuck Gatica. Good night from Oklahoma.